Our candidates forum for Multnomah County Commission District 2. It will last about 30 minutes. I'm your moderator, Debbie Kay, with the League of Women Voters of Portland. The League of Women Voters is a nonpartisan organization that works to help citizens make informed choices for elections. We do not endorse any candidate or political party, but rather we give voters the information they need to make an educated selection. Membership information is available on our website and at the table at the back of the room. This is the fifth of sixth candidate forums that the League of Women Voters is presenting before the May 20 primary election. There is one more after this. All forums will be available for on-demand viewing from a link on our website, lwvpdx.org. To view the forums on local access cable TV, see the playback schedule posted on our website and in your program. Voters can look at our nonpartisan voter's guide for answers to questions posed to all candidates, as well as a balanced presentation of the ballot measure. The voter's guide is here in print form and is on our website, lwvpdx.org. You will also find free copies at Multnomah County Library branches and the Multnomah County Elections Office. Another important voter resource is housed at the Secretary of State's website. It is called ORSTAR and enables you to see the financial sources for campaigns to, in essence, follow the money. Type O-R-E-S-T-A-R into your browser. Finally, to see information about the candidates and ballot measures that will appear on your ballot, go to vote411.org. Enter your street address and the voter's guide information for only those items on your ballot will appear. This is an awesome resource. The candidates in today's forum are running in the May 20th primary election. If one candidate for the position receives 50% plus one of votes in the primary, that candidate will be declared the winner. If no one receives more than 50% of the vote, the top two candidates will appear on the November general election ballot. If you have not yet registered to vote, or if you have moved and need to change your registration, the last day to do so is April 29th. Contact your county elections office or register online at voteoregon.org. Ballots will be mailed beginning on April 30th. And now to our forum. The League of Women Voters has invited all the candidates running for Multnomah County Commissioner Position 2. Present today is Bruce Broussard. Loretta Smith notified us that she was unable to attend. Kelvin Hall and Teresa Rayford are not here, and we are going to move forward. If they come, we will seat them and continue with them as part of the forum. For each round of questions, I will not bother to rotate because we have one person. The candidate will have 1 minute to respond.
Thank you very much.
Members of the audience, as I said, are invited to pose questions. If you already asked your question at the last forum, I have it here. And otherwise, if you have a new question, please write it legibly on a 3x5 card. Timekeepers are sitting in the first row. Thank you very much. They will signal a 15-second warning and then stop when your time has expired. Now let us begin. Bruce Broussard, what would you like voters to know about the county commission and the county commissioner's job?
Well, in all due respect, that's one of the reasons why I'm running. I want to know. That's a very serious problem we have out here because we do have an overlapping situation. It's the largest county in the state. It overlaps the city of Portland. In most cases, most people think about the city of Portland and really not thinking about the services that Multnomah County provides. I'm saying, I'm reacting in all due respect that like most citizens, I live in Jansen Beach or Hayden Island, if you will, and I've got a constituency over there that, like myself, who are very concerned about issues that are facing us over there on the island. We got drug problems, we got crime problems, we got the unemployed, we've got the homeless, and on and on and on. And we've been trying to get the county to get involved in some of the issues that we're interested in. However, we've not gotten any response. So anyway, I stood up one day and I said, okay, fine, I'll run.
Thank you. What changes would you make to rebalance spending between the city of Portland and the county with regard to social services?
First off, I would ask for an audit to find out just exactly how much money the county has. And running for District 2, I'd like to know just exactly how much money I would have, if you will, to provide the services and of the concerns that I have.
What is your opinion of the county's emergency management system, and how well does it coordinate with the management systems of the cities in the county? Well, and if it needs improvement, what do you recommend?
Well, in all due respect, that's one of the things, the concerns I have. You know, I just don't know. Again, that's what I'm saying. I think the citizens want to know specifically what they are doing. And what are we getting for our monies?
How successful is the county's school-based health program, and how does Cover Oregon impact it?
Well, in all due respect, I guess you read in the paper, you know, Cover Oregon is going to be out of business. And that's another confusion. You know, in some cases, I noticed that the sitting commissioner is on radio, if you will, announcing the fact that citizens should sign up, if you will, for Obamacare and also Cover Oregon. And Cover Oregon is going to be going out of business. So citizens are worried, trying to figure out, well, what am I going to do if in fact, Cover Oregon go out of business? Am I going to be covered? What am I going to do? So we're in a confused state. And I'll just put it that way.
And a question about the Wapato Jail. It was built, but is not being used. Mental health patients are being jailed rather than treated. How do you think the commission should approach these issues?
Well, that should have been resolved a long time ago. In fact, it should have been built. It should have had some support, some monies, if you will, to staff the thing to begin with. You know, it's interesting how the sheriff is allowing people to all of a sudden say, gee whiz, we're just overcrowded, and we're just going to have to release folks. And they've got a situation over there that they can actually use that facility, if you will, to house those folks. We shouldn't be letting people out on the street if, in fact, they've committed the crime. Some way, shape, or form, we've got to incarcerate these individuals and do something with them.
How do you imagine the county's role in promoting economic growth in a way that benefits county residents equitably?
Well, again, you know, I'm a businessman. I own my own business. My wife and I own my own business. I've built an apartment complex for seniors. I've owned businesses privately and whatever. And it really bothers me in terms of how we're managing our dollars. And I think they need a change. They need a business person sitting on this council for a change. And I've been there. I look at the bottom line. I know what the bottom line is. And the first thing that I want to know is that how much money do you have to deal with? And specifically, what are the services we're asking to perform? And I think that's a problem.
What can the county do to encourage more stable family wage jobs?
Well, I guess that's everybody's problem, if you will. When you start thinking about stable family wage jobs, if you will, well, who was the one supposed to initiate the jobs to begin with? That's a big question. And you know, first off, I can't answer that in a minute. I'd have to be elected.
It's a secret.
Yes.
What will be your priorities as county commissioner?
Well, the first thing I would want to do is that I'd want to lobby the colleagues and also the chair that they should dedicate one seat that a person will focus on senior citizen issues, veteran issues, and the youth. That would be my first priority. The rationale for that is that, as you know, the city of Portland is bureaucratized. The county isn't. The way it sits now, all county commissioners, including the chair, are basically all county chairs. You know, you don't really know who to call when you call up the county. Who can take care of these senior issues? Who can take care of this gang problem? Who can take care of this? Who can take care of that? They don't know who to call. And that's one of the things I plan to do. As far as I know that the charter, we can't change the charter overnight, but I'm going to lobby the chair to say, okay, fine. Let's at least bureaucratize, give the responsibilities to individuals. And at the same time, give me that responsibility. I will deal with senior citizen issues because, one, I am a senior. I am a senior, and I will definitely commit. I'm 75 years old, and trust me, I am definitely committed. Mental illness, and all due respect, unfortunately, my son, for instance, he was a military person, and he committed suicide right here in this county. Thank you. I'll talk to you about that a little more.
A question from the audience. The description of the big one as a level 9 earthquake is a prediction of a true disaster. It will be a situation in which people will be largely on their own for a period of time because it is likely that streets, bridges, and the transportation in general will be disrupted. How do we facilitate citizens being prepared to take care of themselves?
Well, first off, I'd like to understand what are we doing now, and what are we prepared to do if, in fact, a catastrophe should help? you know, where I come from back in Louisiana, you know, we'd have these storms because I was near the Katrina situation, and we'd have these storms, and folks would come in and work together. We would all work together. If there was a problem, we'd move in other folks' homes, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Today, I don't know what the deal is. It's really sad.
Another audience question. What areas of county services most need improvement in racial equity, and how will you improve equity in county services?
Well, I think one, just setting the example, first of all. I've been in this town. I came here as a Marine recruiter from Vietnam. I served my country, and I've been responsible from day one, if you will. I've worked for various entities. I've run for office, and in many ways, I was elected, but I was elected for a short period of time. The fact of the matter is that you just have to set the example. Well, there's no such thing as a African-American community. There's a community where a number of African-Americans might live and reside, or Asians or whatever. I mean, that's the thing I think we need to do now. We need to stress a little bit more about community. And as Tom McCall has always said, he said, visit but don't stay. And I've known Tom, and we talked about this issue. He said, Bruce, I said, what did you mean by visit but don't stay? He said, Bruce, I'm interested in people living here, not staying here. Visit but don't stay. I'm interested in people living here.
In the recent attempt to locate a Trader Joe's at Northeast MLK Boulevard and Alberta, can you tell us what was the commission's involvement in the discussions with Trader Joe's, the community, and those in opposition to placing a business there? And what, if anything, might we have done differently?
Well, in all due respect, the commission wasn't involved. They should have been involved. Had I been there, what I would have done, I would have contacted the Mayor Charlie Hill and said, Charlie, okay, I understand that Trader Joe's going to be coming in this deal. I'm interested in jobs. I'd like to know specifically how many jobs we're talking about this particular structure. I would like to know how many people are going to be working on this structure. I want to know how many people in my district are going to be working on this structure along that particular line. Once we dotted the I's and crossed the T's, I'd contact my other colleagues and tell them about the situation. Then all of a sudden, we have a shovel situation. After we dotted the I's and crossed the T's and made sure that, in fact, it was going to benefit its citizens, create some jobs, and be a sort of a positive element within our environment.
Another audience question: what should the county do to ensure that fewer youth get into the criminal justice system?
Well, in all due respect, as a Marine recruiter, when I came here, I worked very closely with the court system because of the expungement program. We had an expungement program in the Marine Corps. And I knew all the judges, and the judges would call me up when, in fact, they felt that a young man might be able to get into the service and offset, or if not, rid themselves of a problem from a career standpoint. So I'd go in the court system, and the judge would set aside the situation, and I'd go in, and I'd look at the young man, felt that he could possibly make it, go back in front of the judge. The judge says, okay, fine, you spent 2 years in the military, any military, and you get out, I'll expunge that record. We'll get rid of that record. And I think that's a very important piece. That's what we need to do now. Remember, we went through ballot measure 11, remember? And a lot of those young people did something they shouldn't have done wrong. They should not have done. But now they're adults now. They have no way of i.e. getting into careers or whatever. So I'm going to be working on an expungement program for the county specifically.
Thank you. Are you willing to introduce and support to the commission a measure which requests from the Oregon delegation to the Congress their support for a constitutional amendment which ends the now legal state of money as speech and ends corporations having the constitutional rights of real people?
Boy, that's a big one. I'd like to talk to that person after the deal and come on my show. I'm sorry, it's just a little bit too involved there with me on that one.
Okay. Are you choosing to pass?
Yeah, I'm going to pass on that one. I'm not going to give you something that I just don't understand.
What are the most pressing needs for county services in your district, and how will you address them?
Well, like I said, in my area, we had lottery roll. We've had problems, if you will, with transits in the area and the like. We've had a lot of drug problems and things of that nature. Seniors my wife couldn't walk up to the store the Safeway, if you will, in the evening to get out of the house or something. And that's another major problem. And just some very serious problems. And so what I, again, like I said, we meet on an ongoing basis, but we're only having chats. And I told them, let's act, let's do something about it. And so that's why I'm here. But I want to be able to respond to the entire county. I mean, we have issues like this throughout the county. This is just one segment. I plan to represent the entire county.
Do you think the public is well served by having three levels of government, city, county, and metro? Wouldn't it make sense to consider restructuring and consolidating government functions?
Very much so.
Do you want to elaborate on that?
Well, only from the standpoint, like I said, my first purpose would be to figure out, one, where are the monies, and specifically, what are the services, what overlapping services we're talking about. You know, for instance, you know, we've been, you know, I'll give you a for instance with reference to the homeless, for instance. You know, I was in Trader Joe's the other day, and a young man came in with his dog, and he was pretty well drabby, and this, that, and they're picking over the fruits and this, that, and the other. And folks were very concerned because of how he was dressed and how he was handling all the fruits and whatever. And they were trying to get him out. And my so one of the things I was thinking about is, okay, what do? You call the cops. If you call the cops come in, he gets a clean bed, clean clothes, gets a bath. On the other hand, why not go to Goodwill, have Goodwill put together a cleaning place or whatever where he can wash up, this, that, and the other. And then Goodwill give him some clothing and whatever, and then he can walk out. I mean, let's get the private sector involved in some of the problems that we have.
Thank you. The current immediate challenge with Cover Oregon notwithstanding, what do you think is the best way for the county to coordinate its health care with whatever Cover Oregon becomes?
Well, as you know, they said, well, it's going to probably be Obama plan, for that matter. It's still a confused state. I'm still reminded of the CRC, Columbia River Crossing, and that $200 million that we spent over the last 10 years, and we got nothing but consulting. And I'm looking at the Cover Oregon in that same manner. You know, somebody should have known something, as opposed to going out $250 some odd million. And now they say it's going to cost us about $5 million just to close it up. I don't know what's going on. That's why I want to be elected.
Thank you.
I will find out.
All right. One last question, unless there are more from the audience. Automobile bridges over the Willamette River are owned and maintained by a mix of governmental entities, state, county, and city. Is the current arrangement for maintaining and operating vehicle bridges over the Willamette River optimal? And if not, how should it be improved?
Well, in all due respect, we do need another bridge. We do need a bridge. We do have transportation problems in this area. It's been like this for years, if you will. And so now, I guess we've got planners now that, in all due respect, you're expecting them to respond to the concerns that we're having, and we're not doing it. I'll be right up front with you. And again, that's one of the reasons why I'm running. I'm a businessman. I will ask the questions, and I want answers.
All right. Any more questions from the audience? Okay. Mr. Broussard, you may have a minute for a closing statement.
Okay. I'll just be brief. As you can see, I'm donning this military gear because I wanted to make sure that vets know that I'm here. In fact, even at my restaurant, my wife allows me to put my Marine Corps flag on the wall outside because many vets are out there. They have nowhere to go. They don't know what to say to anyone. We've done this too. And if you notice, I'm donning my T-shirt here called Enormous Kitchen. I'm in business. I'm a private owner, and I'm a family man. And the bottom line is that if you elect me, trust me, you'll have safe streets. We'll deal with the whole issue of some crime. I'm very familiar with the youth. I've owned several entities. I do a talk show called Oregon Voters Digest. If you want to know more about me, you can visit my show, if you will, on Oregon Voters Digest or Bruce Broussard.
Thank you. This concludes the League of Women Voters Multnomah County Commission District 2 Forum. Thank you to Mr. Broussard for joining us today. Thanks to our timekeepers and volunteers from the Portland and East Multnomah County Leagues. Please check our website, lwvpdx.org, to view all our forums on demand and for replay dates, times, and channels for local cable access television. Pick up the League of Women Voters Voter's Guide here and at your local public library. Online, you may check vote411.org for a preview of your personal ballot. Election Day is May 20th. As in all Oregon elections, you will receive a mail-in ballot. Ballots must be mailed back early or delivered to an official drop-off site anywhere in Oregon by 8 o'clock on Tuesday, May 20th. It will probably have stopped raining by then. Postmarks do not count. Mm-hmm. This is Debbie Kay for the League of Women Voters of Portland. Thank you for watching. Please be informed and vote. Your vote really counts. And get all your friends and family to vote, too.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you.